Hi everyone, welcome to another episode of Zootopica, the podcast. Oh, I learned a new word, the VOD.
VOD.
The VOD.
Yeah, VOD. Yes. So this is the video of a pod, a VOD.
The VOD.
There we go.
Where everything zoology, from latest scientific research to day-to-day life to your popular culture, the crazy Hollywood movies, everything meets. I'm Ruchira Somaweera. I'm a zoologist and I'll be your host. Joining me is none other than Pete Curulli.
Yes, hi, how are you going? I'm not a zoologist. I have absolutely nothing to do with animals. I never have done. I have a dog. I once owned a fish that didn't go well. Although I did a family business, fresh seafood back in the day as well. So
I tested some octopus.
Yes, you did. Yeah. Did you like it?
Absolutely.
I have some more. I've got some more octopus back here. That's probably been a little bit too long there.
But I'm really excited to be a part of this. I'm a radio host.
So he's from the Big Boys Club. This is your bread and butter, right?
Talking into microphones. Not so much the Zootopica stuff. That's your bread and butter
But that's a good combination because so you host the 92.9 breakfast show.
Yeah, Xavier, Massive. Jules and Pete.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Big deals. Mm. And you have your own podcast, right?
Yes.
Game
on Oz. So that's a podcast which turned into a bit more of a media beast. So now it's news and reviews and interviews and Twitch streams and video and VODs. And all sorts of other stuff as well, and a little bit of esports events and yada yada yada, and pentanet.gg. I got to make a mention of them as well. So yeah, you know what, just living life really, Roo.
See, that's where I want to get this going at one day.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a simple start for that.
I think you're in a good position to do that, particularly with the sort of things that we're going to be covering today, because I find this very interesting. Love in the animal world.
Yeah, so we post a theme for each week, and what was it? Love in the animal world. And you guys have sent some amazing questions. We compiled them, got few to represent the broader picture, and we are going to discuss them.
I love this. So love in the animal world, like this is an all of the above kind of love in the animal world. We're going to be going here, there, and everywhere talking about love. It's not just about lizards, for example. It's just a bit of love in
absolutely
general.
Absolutely. So I mean, and as you know, I mean, love can be a lot of things. Mm. Right, by the way, this is our mascot. It's a Komodo dragon from Komodo village.
Can I ask you a question about Komodo just quickly? And I know we'll get to this, but did I hear that recently that they're under the threat of extinction, the Komodo dragons?
So there was a lot of information going on with Komodo National Park shutting down too.
Yes.
Look, I mean, they are at the moment in the island itself, they are not under threat.
Right.
There was a talk that something like the cane toad in Australia, mm-hmm. there was another toad called the black spine toad. Mm. It was invading that area, and that if the toads, make it to Komodo Island, and if these guys eat them, they don't have the resistance for the toxic.
Right.
So they'll die. But like at the moment, no.
Okay. Well, that's good news.
Yeah.
Now, can I, so we've got these questions that you've sent in.
Yeah.
And I'm going to read you these questions.
Yeah, let's discuss one.
You're going to answer them. But can I hit you with my own question first?
Absolutely. I mean, that's why I'm always having a non-sciencey co-host made of mine. So you are representing everyone who's not here to ask questions.
Right. I'm your average Joe. And I'm about as non-sciencey as you'll get. So my question is, and I suppose this is a very broad question, but do animals know they're in love when they're in love?
Mm.
If that makes sense. Like humans know, my wife and I, for example, we know we're in love. We love each other.
We
do all that. That's all.
So it's more than, just to set the premise, and I think this is relevant to pretty much all the questions. Animals have three things in mind, right? To eat enough, mm-hmm. not to get eaten, mm-hmm. and to mate and make babies.
Right.
So the whole, and their life, the entire life is kind of oriented or focused on those three, making those three happen. But in that case, like, love is not about necessarily caring for another person. It's about making babies.
Right.
So love is always relevant or related to reproduction.
Yeah.
And that's that selfish gene. Like, it's all about spreading your genes. Right? So it's a completely different level of love.
Got a few mates of mine that I went to school with that are about that kind of love.
I would say a lot of there's a fair bit of humans like that too.
Okay, let's dive into our first one here. So this is from Jamelia. I love this. We're not just local, but international questions coming through.
Absolutely.
So Jamelia in Washington, D.C., has said, do animals weep when they lose a loved one? Do they show the emotion of grief?
Ooh. Okay, so weep as in crying?
Crying. I'm going to go with crying. I think that's what she means by weeping and crying. Yeah.
So I have seen plenty of especially on social media, you see animals with tears coming and they're like, oh my God, like this is animal cruelty. This is like this animal is in pain, which is not actually true. So the crying as a physical activity does not happen as an expression of emotion in animals. Right. It's mostly the lubricant in the eye, the moisturizer, or sometimes it's a way of getting rid of excessive salt and other chemicals from the body.
Okay.
So it's a completely different process to expressing a feeling, yep. Right? But said that, grief, we believe they do. It's one of the tricky ones. So it's because a lot of to confirm in science, to get a confirmation that this is happening, you can't based on something anecdotal, something opportunistic that you see in the wild, right? You stage experiments, you actually make sure that repetitively they're showing the same thing. So you can make sure, okay, this is definitely the feeling that they're having.
Yeah.
Something like happiness. You throw a biscuit at a dog and it's like, he's happy. There's some obvious signs that it shows that, oh my God, like I'm over the top now.
Oh, the wagging of the tail.
Yeah, exactly. And all exactly. Stuff. Yep. The sounds they make, the body chemistry, everything changes. Pain. Like if an animal is in pain, you can, there are signs that you can feel, like the noises it makes, right? The body posture. Grief is a hard one to actually stage and study. What are you going to do? Like having two monkeys kill one and see what the other one do? You can't do that, right? So what we know about animal grief comes from observations people have made in the wild. Based on those, we think that certain animals certainly show signs of grief. Like elephants, for example, if one of their loved ones die, especially if a calf die, they'll hang around for days sometimes, touching it with their trunk, right? There has been evidence that dolphins would push and still try to swim with their dead babies.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Monkeys do that a lot. Like I have personally seen two species of monkeys carrying their dead babies.
Yeah.
One was like rotten and maggots falling off, but it was still holding it. And it's known from a lot of primates. So there are certain signs that animals show which can be interpreted as showing grief or losing a loved one.
More complex, and I don't quite know, like sort of the scale of what a brain looks like in an animal and how it acts and all that sort of stuff. But the more complex animals, like
the intellectually capable ones, you mean?
Yeah, because like a fish, you wouldn't show grief.
See, you are right. So, I mean, that's another one. Good that you brought that up, because Jane Goodall, who's this legendary chimpanzee researcher, Dr. Jane Goodall. So I recall reading in one of her work that one of the chimpanzees went into this grief mode after his friend died to the level that it died in a few days, like of not like complete depression, not eating, nothing.
Yeah,
right. So as you said, like dolphins, elephants, chimpanzees, these are all into like smart animals that you think of. And the problem here, Pete, is that like sometimes it's hard to interpret what you see because animals can't tell, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, oh my God, Charlie's dead. I'm sad. Mm. You can't express that. So we use these cues to think that this is what they're doing. A good example is, do you know what a collective noun for crows are?
It's a murder, isn't it?
It is. Yes,
right.
Yeah, well done. What about owls?
Oh, hang on, wait, no. It's a parliament.
Yeah. Hold on. It's funny, yeah, like because we see owls as these wise things. Maybe a long time ago, parliaments had wise people.
Yeah.
Maybe. So the murder of crows, that name comes from when, if you see a whole bunch of crows on a tree or somewhere making that annoying noise, all of a sudden, a whole bunch of them, chances are there's a dead crow nearby.
Yeah.
Right? When one of their comrades fall, they all get together and like actually spend some time screaming at it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, yeah. So that name, Murder of Crows, comes from that.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So, but the initial explanation for that was that, okay, they are kind of paying tribute to the fallen comrade. Oh my God, Charlie's dead. Let's all say a few words. Mm. And they're all making that annoying noise. But a more recent, another alternative explanation for that is because they are smart animals, since you mentioned like whether these are smart animals that show this behavior.
So can I just really quickly, yeah, yeah. I don't know if this is taboo, but I've grown up in a family where we go and hunt from yep. time to time. And we yep. only kill what we're going to eat and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
But one of the things that we've noticed, you just mentioned intelligence in crows, right?
Yeah.
This was the moment where I went, oh my God, crows are so smart. I was walking around with a shotgun and there was a crow and I was tracking it. I wasn't going to shoot it, but I was just trying to get close enough to it. And every time I got within a few meters of it, it would take off and just get away a little bit further.
Right.
I put the I swear this happened. I put the shotgun down and then tracked it again and it let me get closer to it. It let me get this close to it.
So it didn't see you as a threat.
Yes.
So, okay, that's brilliant info, what I was going to say, because the another alternative explanation as to why these crows get together and scream at this dead one is not, it's not about the dead one. It's about learning what killed it.
Right.
So look, Charlie's dead. Let's see what are the threats here so no one else get into trouble again.
Yeah.
Right. So it's that perceived threat that they are identifying. So, And crows are smart. So what you see could be a behavior that it's not seeing you as a threat. A lot of animals would be scared if you're holding a stick, right? But not if you are like with your hands down, right? So similarly, what I was going through at was some of these behaviors, when you see them, you think that they're actually sad, they're grieving, but it could be other reasons too. But in general, animals, we have credible evidence to at least for certain animals that they do feel grief. Yeah.
Wow,
when their
amazing.
Loved ones are dead. That's actually a good question to start with.
Just really quickly, do fish cry? Do they? Or do they weep?
No.
Would you ever know? Like,
one thing I know is that fish actually shed their skin,
right?
So like reptiles, but because they're in an aquatic environment, it just get dissolved.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So I don't know about crying. I don't know about crying, but a lot of animals that lives in the ocean have a way of getting rid of excess salt because they're eating stuff with salt, right?
Yeah.
And too much salt makes your body hypersaline. So you need to get rid of that. And one way of like turtles do this, you'll see turtles when they come out, like there's tears dropping, and that's this excess salt leaving. Maybe something like that is happening in fish. I've never thought of fish crying.
I'm gonna figure that one out. Okay, Jason in Sydney. I like this question. What animal species are truly monogamous? So for people who don't know what monogamy is, first,
please go first.
Oh, I have no idea what monogamy is. Absolutely no idea. I cannot manage that definition. I defer to you, sir.
Short question, not a single animal is truly monogamous, so we can move on, but let's expand on that.
So I hear it all the time. Like, there's particular examples of animals that when they mate for life. And I don't know which ones it is.
Yeah, yeah. So monogamy in the animal world refers to, say, I told that animals have three problems, right? One is like mating and getting your gene spread.
Mm.
So monogamy in that context is exclusive commitment to one partner during a breeding season, right? So you make babies together and look after the babies. So monogamy in the human society is more like being loyal and committed to one person. That's monogamy compared to polygamy, where you just you do whatever.
Floating around.
In the animal world, it takes a step ahead that, okay, it's not about just having sex with, like limiting exclusive sex to one partner, but bringing up the babies together. In that context, we don't know of a single species. Like, it's very commonly said in popular media that, okay, penguins mate for life, swans, like they're the signature of love because they're so committed to each other. Science tells otherwise, right? So there's not a single species that is as a species level, like every single individual in that species is monogamous. It's not the case. Yeah. We believe that was the case for a long time till DNA fingerprinting came.
So DNA fingerprinting?
DNA fingerprinting is basically your paternity test. It's like finding who's your daddy. Right? So you take some genes and you can track down, are all the babies in this clutch from one daddy, or are there a few daddies involved?
And are there more daddies for the babies?
Yeah. So what we now know is that animals, instead of being truly monogamous, they show what's called social monogamy.
Yeah.
Social monogamy is like, look, for most of the time, you are committed to one person, but once in a while, when you see that extra hot animal, you're like, you know what?
Girl, you're beefy.
and it happens in both sides, like females and males.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's an evolutionary reason for that. Like it's, if you see a male that's superior, you want some of that genes in your babies. Mm. Right? Okay, go for it. And in the male's point of view, it's like, oh, look, I have more opportunities to spread my genes. Why not? So so social monogamy, yes. True monogamy, not. We know that, at least about 80-90% of birds are actually socially monogamous. They stick together for at least one season or multiple seasons.
Yeah.
So it's a spectrum. Right? But there's a reason for that compared to mammals. Like, we are mammals. Mm. What do mammals babies... How do mammals baby grow? Like, your kids. What did they feed in the beginning?
Well, mother's milk.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, the dad actually don't have a role, right?
Yes, yeah.
You don't have to feed the kid.
No.
So, you could not care less. As an animal, you're like, all right, I'm done. I'll move to the next one, right? In birds, it's different.
Because... Well, I know a few blokes like that, though, by the way.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
But in birds, it's a different scenario because both mom and dad has to feed this growing chick.
Yeah,
so you need that commitment.
Yeah.
Right? So because of that, in birds, social monogamy is common. In mammals, no.
Right.
So not a single animal is, as a species, mates for life. It's a spectrum. Some animals hang around for one season, some around more than one season for multiple seasons. But there's always that exception. So not as a species now.
Okay. Now this next question comes from Benji in Perth. Hello, Benji. And this is very much there's probably different answers for this in 2020 than there would have been maybe 20 or 30 years ago. But why is it that in some species like ostriches, the dads look after the babies, not the mums?
Oh, so daddy care.
Daddy care.
Daddy care. Similar to most human families, moms play a major role in bringing up babies in the animal world. Dads taking over is the exception. It's actually rare. Mm. And Benji is right. Like in ostriches, you see that. There are a few other animals, and it's called paternal care instead of maternal care. Paternal care for dads looking after the babies.
Just like dads, like humans, we have paternity leave.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, like similar. But remember I said like most birds are monogamous and they, because they have to feed the babies together.
Yeah.
So it's mostly those birds that are monogamous that do paternal care. And even then it's biparental normally. It's not one, like just the daddy do it and then the mom just do her own thing. It's like both still doing the job.
Yeah, right.
In some fish, like pipefish, seahorses, you have seen seahorses, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So they actually take it to the next level. Their dads have this brooding pouch.
I've seen this. And you see all the little tiny ones pop
out. Exactly. Yeah. So they are actually, the dad plays a huge role because he has to protect them and carry them. Physically hold them. Whereas in birds, it's normally both parents, But there's few like explanations for that. Well, one of the more credible ones is that the dad takes some, it's selfish again. Like it's like, okay, you have some rest, so you'll be ready for the next mating season sooner.
Right.
It's not that, okay, because her burden for looking after babies is lessened.
Yeah.
Right? So it's not like, okay, I love you, so I'm going to help you. It's like, you know what? I'll look after this. You just be ready. So animals, that's how animals roll.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Something to take away from that. Okay. I have another question that's just popped into my head, but I think I'm gonna save it to the end of the VOD.
Okay.
Because it's out of left field.
We'll certainly do that.
Dr. Ru, learning a lot from your show. This is from Amesh in Chennai.
India.
Thank you. I would like to know which animal is closest to us humans when it comes to showing love to their partner. I love this question.
So, Amesh, is it?
Yes.
So, Amesh, I think it comes to your question as you, the first question you asked, whether animals show love as humans do.
Yes.
Which they don't.
Do they show the emotion of grief?
Yeah, the question before that, when you asked like whether animals show their love.
Yep.
So no animal actually shows love in the intention of like showing compassion and oh my god, I really want you in my life kind of a love. It's for obvious reasons. It's all about spreading the genes. Like it's for a male, right?
So if this question was more like, I would like to know which animal is closest to us humans when it comes to one night stands.
Oh,
then
they're pretty much every mammal.
Boom.
Yeah, but like, there's no way of like pointing out which animal is the best lover in the animal world.
Mm.
But if I had to pick a group, it'll be birds.
Birds.
Oh yeah, birds go extra, like absolute extra when it comes to showing off, right? Some of the stuff. Some birds are like birds of paradise. These are like amazingly colorful birds in Papua New Guinea.
Yeah.
They go over the top to like show that, oh my God, I'm the dancers to displays. It's just crazy.
If you and
just...
does it work though? Or did it, because look, when I used to go out, I would wear.
This is like 40 years ago. Yeah.
15, come on.
Yeah.
Okay. I would wear, I'd be out with the boys.
Yeah.
And I'd have my hair slicked back.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'd wear my silk shirt.
Yeah.
I'd have my gold chain all shiny and blingy, you know, that sort of stuff. I'd be walking around and buying drinks and whatnot. And is it the equivalent of that? Like,
absolutely.
I'm showing my feathers.
Absolutely. Like it's a sign, like, so animals always give multiple cues out there, from looks to noises to vibrations to tactiles to chemicals. So, females decide based on a combination of all these, like which is the strongest, which are the strongest genes. Because at the end of the day, it's about survival of the offspring. So if you're having good genes, your chances of becoming like, how they measure good genes is from looks mostly.
Right.
In birds, at least. That's why in birds, the males are super colorful because it's all about sexual, it's all about showing off, displaying to the female and to other males.
Yeah.
Saying that, look, I'm the alpha here. Do you know why? Like in humans, right? Girls always dress up better than guys. Like that's
absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's normal. Yeah. In the animal world, it's the opposite. Like in most animal groups, the girls or the females are very dapper in color and males are extremely colorful. And in birds, at least, one reason is that the female has to stay in the nest, incubating the eggs for a long time in one place.
Mm.
If you are showing off to the whole world that, oh, like with your reds and purples and everything, that I'm here, you are easy target, you are easy food,
mm-hmm.
right? So you need to be camouflaged.
Yeah.
Whereas males do whatever,
yeah.
right? And it's all about showing off. So so birds, best lovers as in, birds take it to different level
right.
In displays. And also like bringing in things, like giving gifts.
Like shiny things.
Shiny things, right? Yeah.
Pick up
yeah.
shiny things.
Exactly, like, there's quite a few birds doing that. And bowerbirds make these structure just to impress a girl, and if it is not good enough, he'll make another one. What a waste of time. Like absolutely spending the entire, some of those don't even eat, like, and focus on that.
Yeah.
Like hornbills, for example, like we'll bring food for the for his wife or the partner during when she's looking after the eggs. They do it to a next level. Some fish, the next category would be fish. Fish also, some, especially the like the cichlids, which you are like your tilapia,
yeah.
which you eat. Yeah, yeah. Those guys.
So
like,
run that by me again. Cichlids.
Cichlids is the group of fish that tilapia belongs to, like the common tilapia.
What's a tilapia?
Oh, okay. If you go to Coles today, it's one of the most commonly eaten fish in the world.
Oh, so something like a hake or a bass.
Yeah. It's an African origin, but it's so commonly introduced to like pretty much the entire world now.
Gotcha. Yeah.
And you get them in supermarkets here too.
Does it taste any good? Is it all right?
I actually don't mind.
Yeah, mind it.
But these guys bring like dead snail shells and pebbles.
Do they?
Yeah, yeah, just to impress their girls.
But they're just fish.
Yeah,
like,
but
they're, like, that's the thing. Fish, they're not meant to be intelligent like those sort of fish. So what is it? And I, look, I may have the wrong read on that.
Yeah.
Maybe they are intelligent and I don't know that, obviously. But if they're just about as intelligent as just about every other fish out there,
yeah,
then is there something else driving that? Is it pure instinct driving that will to grab those things and bring them? Or is there something actually ticking over in their head going, I'm going to go and get that shell and I'm going to bring it here and I'm going to pop it there and she's going to love it.
I think we need a complete episode on this because those social behaviors shown by some of the animals, including tilapias or like the cichlids, are next level. I mean, there's the alpha ones who do this, and then there's the sneaky beta ones hanging around and the females hanging out with the alpha as soon as he goes to pick another snail shell.
Yep.
These things come and mate and poof, off.
Yeah.
So it's a completely different social structure in these social fish.
Bang, boom.
Yeah, done.
In and out, done.
Yeah.
Jeez.
There you go.
Okay. Anne in Dunedin, which is in New Zealand.
Dunedin. That's the first one. First time I always call it Dunedin.
Oh, you know what? I think it is Dunedin.
Yeah, I was there in December.
I think it's Dunedin. You've been there, you said?
Yeah, okay.
Well, yeah, it's beautiful. Dunedin then.
It's Dunedin. Sorry, Anne.
Yep. No, sorry, Anne. Are there any examples in the animal world where females display and attract males for courtship? So we're putting this on. So this is
the
like,
other way around.
This is like the equivalent of the woman asking a man to marry.
Yeah.
If so, what is the evolutionary significance of it? So we'll get to that second. But
yeah.
That first one, the women taking it on versus men. Like, does that happen or?
So, okay. So basically, it's extremely rare. It's absolutely rare. I think we discussed a few points before too, like the whole point of why the males are so colorful is that their life is surrounded around getting a female. So there are many in many animal groups. There's a whole bunch of males displaying. Could be visual, could be calling like the frogs, could be tactile, could be chemical. And then one female comes and she decides, you. Okay? The other way around is extremely rare to the level that it almost doesn't happen. Females don't line up and a guy comes and like, you. Right? It doesn't happen.
Like the bachelor.
Yeah. So there's no animal bachelor.
Yeah, okay.
So, but there are few examples. You remember those monogamous birds, socially monogamous birds that pair for seasons?
Yeah.
In some of them, they both display to each other instead of like the male doing everything and the female deciding, you're good, you're all right.
Mm.
They're like, oh, okay, I'll do a dance, you do a dance. So there's all these mating rituals.
I've seen them. Yes, I have seen them.
Yeah.
And does it happen is there snakes that do it as well, that do the mating?
So that is actually different? Not a display. That's actually mating. Snakes do that for two reasons.
Yeah.
Sometimes if you see two snakes wrapped around and trying to push others' head down, those are normally two males. Those are combats, like mating combats, showing who's the boss.
Right.
Yeah, it's like, this is my... This
do
is
they
my...
actually kill each other? Or is it just about getting on top of the other and pushing him down and I'm asserting my authority?
Exactly.
Here.
So killing each other in combat in animal world is extremely rare.
Yeah, right.
Between two animals in the same species. They're normally hurting the other one or actually just showing off so the other one backs up.
Yep.
Killing is an extreme event. So normally those snakes are combating and showing who's the boss. Right, in birds, some birds, especially Sarus crane. So, like in I think it's Japanese culture. There's these drawings, ancient drawings of cranes displaying, like dancing.
Mm.
I could be wrong. Could be Chinese. I'm absolutely sorry. Then there's grebes. Grebes are these teeny weeny duck-like things. You see them in herdsman lake too. And they have these mating rituals like dancing. And both display to each other. And there are songbirds, especially in some of the European ones. They sing to each other. Now, we think, because it's asked what's the significance of it, we think that because these are monogamous, they want to make sure that both are compatible.
Right.
Rather than saying, okay, because it's not a one-off, in one-off animals, this never happens. It's like the polygamous animals. It's mostly a whole bunch of males displaying, and the female normally have a choice as to what. In some animals, they don't even have that. Like in some animals, when an alpha male kills the male of another group, he just have access to all the females.
Is that like lions?
Yeah, like exactly. Oh, yeah. So there's no like, okay, whether you like it or not, like you're mine. Whereas some of the socially monogamous birds, they do in courtship being mating. Before mating, they both display to each other. But I can't think of a single example where just the female do everything and the males come and pick. Oh, is it the other way?
Yeah.
So
I believe that was the human race in the 1950s. If
not that long ago.
Yeah. Where the female was expected to do everything.
Unfortunately, it's still the case in some societies.
Yes. No, yeah. It is. Very much so. Much better here in Australia.
Absolutely.
Okay. So I'll tell you what. I'm going to save... now, please forgive me. Thanuja.
Thanuja, yeah.
Thanuja.
Sri Lanka.
From Sri Lanka. Let's save that as a second last one.
Right.
Because someone's just popped into my head.
Yeah.
Asexual species.
Yeah.
Do they experience love? Or like, do they experience...
What do you mean an asexual species?
Maybe I've got it wrong. So, okay. What I'm trying to get at is the ones that can... Are there species of animal that can reproduce themselves?
Yeah, they can.
So reproduce themselves.
Okay.
But also like your species of say amphibians, for example, that can go from male to female and change. Yeah. There's also that.
Yeah.
So like, do they? How does that all fit into everything when it comes to this?
Yeah. So that's actually a pretty good question.
Thank you.
There you go. So most of these, we call them hermaphrodites. Hermaphrodites are when an animal has both the female bits and the male bits, right? So you can literally mate with any other animal, any other individual.
Mm-hmm.
Because the other animal would have both bits too, right? So...
That'd be confusing, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it is. But most of these hermaphrodites are actually very primitive animals. We see them in worms, we see them in some insect groups. We see them in fish, but hermaphrodites are very rare in developed, like more evolved animals. More evolved animals would be one sex or the other.
Right.
And because the emotions and love and all these things have been mostly studied in the evolved animals, we don't know what the more primitive, whether two worms are in love, for example, right?
Yeah, okay.
We won't know that.
Yeah.
The sex reversal is a completely different thing. Fish do that. Like sometimes fish do that, some amphibians do that. They actually reverse sex. They can become a male, can become a female, or a female can become a male.
And would their behavior change with it? So, for example, if you were talking about what were those fish again that
cichlids.
Bring the snails?
Cichlids.
So if cichlids could do it, would then, you know, if the female is waiting for a cichlid to bring its snail shells and then decides, no, I'm going to be a male and changes its gender, then would its behavior change with that?
So normally in most of these groups, the sex reverse, this normally happens in species that lives as a group, right? And it's either like a matriarchal group, meaning a female is leading the group, or is it patriarchal, whatever the opposite of matriarchal, anyway, a male group. Normally the sex reversals normally doesn't happen as like, you know what, I'm going to be a girl tomorrow. It doesn't happen like that. It normally happens when the matriarch dies or the leader dies, someone takes that place.
Right.
So do a sex reversal. And again, it's for the survival of the species, the survival of the group. All right. So she takes, like when a sex reversal happened, she's 100% female then, like behaviorally, how she looks like, everything. It's amazing what some of these animals do.
Unreal.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go to Thanonja. From Kandy, Sri Lanka. It always puzzled me as to how birds like penguins and albatross that live in large colonies identify their own offspring among hundreds of others upon returning to the colonies after months at sea. Can you shed some light on how they do this?
That has fascinated scientists for a long time, because some of these penguins are in groups of thousands.
Well, they all look the same.
It's funny you mentioned that, because talking about monogamy too, I saw this meme. I heard that penguins mate for life. I'm not surprised, because they all look the exact same. It's not that one day a penguin going to see, oh, wow, that one's hot.
Yeah.
Right? It's like they look the exact same. So,
exactly.
Yeah, so...
Maybe they're looking for personality. I don't
know. I mean, they look the same. They pretty much, like for us, they sound the same. And there's thousands of them. And like some of the bigger penguin species, like the king penguins, they are gone for months in the sea feeding.
Mm.
And they come back. And among hundreds and thousands of, these babies and other males, they manage to find their individuals, right? So, and some of the other seabirds do that too. Gulls sometimes, albatross. So what we know is that they make a very specific sound. In penguins, it has been studied that they make a two-note sound, like that is absolutely not the sound they make, but like just a two-note sound. But depending on the length of those sounds and the frequency of those sounds, among these thousands, there'll be a unique signature that your baby would understand, or your baby will identify that.
That blows my mind, because we're talking about a group of thousands.
Yeah,
so,
and they're all calling at the same time.
All calling at the same time.
Yeah.
And like, the, you know, there's got to be just... perceivably, if they make two sounds, then surely you're going to run out of options at some point, or there's going to be some penguin that's got to be going for like 6 hours at a time in two notes, Morse code, to be identifying. How complex do these sounds get?
So animal communication is something that we have barely understood so far, right? It's beyond what we think. So we are at very early stages of understanding how animals communicate with each other, and how, I mean, as you said, like when there's thousands and you can't even see, you only see the ones in the front, right? Mm-hmm. Because it's your same height, and there could be thousands behind you, but you know that among all these sounds, it's like, bam, okay, my baby is like 10 foot this way and 10 foot that way. That's just possible. That's just amazing. But it has been actually shown that they are making very unique sounds that is a signature which is different in the length and frequency to that particular family that they can actually understand. People have done playback studies. So when you play back certain sounds and see how animals react, and they're very uniquely reacting to certain sounds. Not only birds, like crocodiles do that too. Crocodiles are one of the very few animal groups, reptile groups, that communicate using sound, right? So the study showing that when babies make sound, certain individuals, especially their moms, are more sensitive to those sounds compared to the others. So we are at a very early stage. So Tanuja, basically what we know is that it's based on sound, and it's this very unique sound signal, a signal based on how the length of the sound and the frequency of the sound, that signature is uniquely understood by only one among those thousands.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
The it's sort of brought me into just another thought of popping in my head. So we've mentioned things like, you know, like do we sort of covered, do animals get feelings about each other?
Yeah.
You know, through things like, do they show emotion of grief and stuff like that? What about, you know, we're sort of thinking about love in the animal world in terms of husband meets wife.
Yeah.
But what about like mother and father and child? So
mating with your...
No, not mating with, but more so like protection, like sort of thing. So the love that I feel for my kids, obviously I can explain it in words and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
Right? But, you know, you can see it very easily in humans.
Yeah.
Through the way that we hold our kids, talk about our kids, and we can display our emotions and stuff of love.
Yeah.
Does the animal world, or do we identify that in the animal world as well? Or is it purely instinct driving things like securing your kids, their kids, like that?
A bit of both. So we know that at least in the more advanced, and at least in the mammals, there's certainly very strict parental care. Like you have a preference for your baby and you look after them. And more or less the same, as I said, like monkeys carry their dead babies with us, right?
Yeah.
There's a study, can't remember where, but sea lions, when their babies get eaten by sharks and orcas and whatnot that eat babies out there, the moms make this very unique sound that you'd never hear other times. So they certainly sure.
Is that a grief sound or a warning sound? Or is it a warning sound?
We believe it's a griefing sound because warning, it's a completely different one to seeing a threat out there.
Yeah.
Yep. So there's certainly a large scale of parental care happening. And that happens in, it happens to an extraordinary level in some of the lower animals too. Animals that we don't think much, like frogs, right? There are frogs like poison arrow frogs. There are species that carry a tadpole in their back, go from one tree hole to the other, or like bromeliads are these plants that grow in Amazon. They collect water in the canopy. Mm. So there are species that grows in them. So when that dries out, the dad normally carries the tadpole to another one with water. So this is for a frog. We don't even think they'll do that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. There's this, like African giant frogs dig canals to make sure that enough water comes to the tadpole pond. So animals take it to next level when it comes to looking after their babies compared to showing love to their partners.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, yeah. That's so that bond is extremely strong.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, so questions have been wonderful, and thank you everybody who sent them in. I've got one more here, and this is off the back of I hear those stories from time to time of, say for example, dolphins and their trainers.
Yeah.
And I have heard stories, and I don't know if it's true or not, where the dolphins become infatuated with their trainers and even try to crack onto their trainers sometimes.
Yeah, right.
Now, not at that particular level, cross species in terms of, you know, like animals and humans.
Yeah.
But is there such a thing as genuine cross species love or mating that has been identified out there? And it's not by accident, but it's on purpose.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So as I said, I mean, how we show love for an animal, it's completely different thing. Mostly in those scenarios, it's a reward system. Like showing love is because you know that once you show love, you get something in return. Like if it is a dolphin in an aquarium, it's being fed. It's that bond that sometimes a dog have with its master, right? That's a completely different one. That's loyalty. Sometimes it's a reward based system. In the wild, you see some animals are more social than the others, but not to the level that they are pairing up. However, said that hybrids are when two species breed each other.
Yeah.
Hybrids are not uncommon in the animal world. There are multiple natural hybrids, especially in fish and amphibians. Hybrids are common. There are a lot of hybrids in birds. In captivity, we have created so many hybrids, especially with the big cats. Like you can cross a lion and a tiger.
Mm-hmm.
We call it a liger or a tiglion based on who's the dad.
That's what makes it different. Because I've heard both, the tiglion and the liger. I always thought it was just a personal choice, so whoever's breeding it.
No. If the daddy is a lion, it's a liger. If the mum is if the daddy is a tiger, it's a tiglion.
Gotcha.
Or the other way around. But it depends on who the dad is.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So So all these fancy crosses. I mean that TV series on TV, what is it? Netflix, there was one recently, The Lion The Tiger King.
Tiger King.
There's so many ligers and tiglions in that movie, in that TV series.
Where the animals in that one were actually the humans, not animals in cages. Yeah,
in both parties. So hybrids are common, and that happens in the wild too. So cross species love, there's nothing called love as per se, like caring for the other one, but cross species mating and reproduction, yes, it happens. Now, the traditional definition of a species in science was if two animals can breed and their offspring can also breed, like make fertile young, that was called a species, right? Uh-huh. So, for example, do you know what happens if a donkey crosses a horse?
A donkey and a horse?
Yeah. You get a mule.
I wanted to say honky. So it's a mule. All right, it's a mule. So that's what a mule is.
Yeah, okay. It's a mule is a cross between a donkey and a horse, right?
Right.
But mules can't make babies themselves because they are infertile.
Ah.
That's why their dad and mum are two different species.
Wow. Yeah.
So there are hybrids happening in the world, But normally, the offspring can't breed themselves.
So is there a, is there an offspring that can, or is that sort of more been, I suppose, like cross species within species?
So,
birds and birds, for example.
Yeah, so the funny thing is that if an offspring of one of those offspring from a hybrid can breed with another male and make fertile young. Oh, I don't know whether they're fertile, but can make young. For example, a liger can breed with a lion and make a liliger.
A liliger?
A liliger, yeah.
What is it if it's a Tiglion? Can a Tiglion do the same thing?
I'm sure a Tiglion can mate with a like another male.
Yeah.
And there's this graph that there's... It's crazy. I mean, those cat breeders go for crazy levels of making weird stuff.
Oh,
yeah.
That's amazing.
But wow. Yeah, that's the beauty of the animal world.
Well, I've certainly learned a lot. It's opened my eyes. I'm not going to look at certain species the same anymore. But thank you for having me. This is extraordinary. So, Zootopica, loving the animal world. Have you got any sort of ideas as to what episode 4 is going to be about?
So, episode 4, we are thinking about sharks.
Sharks.
Everything about sharks.
I love sharks.
Right? So, yeah. We'll post the notice soon. And, Pete, I think we have to tell where we are.
Yes, we are. So, we're at Scitech. So, this is the Western Australian Science and Technology Discovery Centre. This is a place growing up in Perth, born and bred here in Perth, WA.
Yeah.
I came here on many school excursions when I was a kid. Field trips. We're actually inside one of the science, like the centers within the science center, where you can come and actually discover things. They put certain things on. There's a heap of all sorts of technical equipment and microscopes and all sorts of stuff around us at the moment. Beautiful colors through the center and whatnot. But just an absolutely extraordinary place. So Scitech WA, thank you for having us today, Scitech.
Thank you, Scitech. Absolutely. So we are going to bring this, bring episodes from all the science institutes and other animal related places. So we can actually, relate to that too.
Unreal.
Well, thank you again for joining us, and we will see you on the next episode on sharks. Thanks, Pete.
Bye-bye. Thanks, Rick.
Thanks, man.
Bang.